outside of Davis Wade Stadium right now. We're sort of in the middle of all the action. We got the people with the cowbells behind us. Everyone is so excited.
Tom, yes, they were able to get the win tonight. 11-7, the final score. As Mississippi State, the Bulldogs, they get to change their name to the Oma Dogs, as you can see on the screen behind me, because they are going to the College World Series.
Meridian has been the team to beat this season in 6A, compiling an impressive 29-1 overall record. But the circumstances were much different just two short seasons ago, when the Lady Cats weren't winning and barely had fans in attendance at their games.
Basketball is back after the NBA and its Players Association agreed on the final few terms to restart the season in Orlando. The official restart schedule was released this evening. One game that I knew was going to be really tough for the Tigers that they ended up falling in was Valdosta State. Now, they were the reigning Gulf South Conference champions, so we knew it was going to be a tough game for them. But overall record last season for them, they had a 6-5 overall record, which I don't really think on paper kind of shows how well they were as a team. I think there were a couple of games that were winnable games for them that they just didn't quite close out on. The end of today's super regional matchup between Alabama and Kentucky was a bit of a nail biter, but in the end, the tie, they would come out on top and are now one win away from the College World Series.
You talked about it already, going to be a very physical matchup here tonight. How do you get your guys ready to play an opponent like that that's going to bring so much physicality in?
A couple more state game events left, mountain biking and I think martial arts.
Martial arts. That martial sounds arts. Fun, actually.
All like right. My martial arts moves?
There you go. I like them.
Zach Gaines is a senior punter at the University of West Alabama, a D2 program that's produced notable NFL players like Malcolm Butler and Tyreek Hill. But a different NFL player sparked Zach's interest in punting when he was 9 years old.
My dad, his best friend in high school was Jason Elam. He graduated high school with him. He's a Hall of Fame kicker in the NFL. And so growing up with him, my dad learned, you know, certain techniques for kicking and punting and whatnot. And he kind of just said, hey, you know, you need something to fall back onto if you get injured. And long story short behind that, you know, I got injured my senior year and had something to fall back onto. So
Zach played at Calera High School in Alabama. It was game one of his senior season. While making a tackle on defense, Zach's leg twisted in the wrong direction, and the player he tackled fell on top of it. It was his right leg, the same leg he used for punting. It had been broken in two places.
I got selfish for a few days after the injury, a few days after I got surgery on my leg and whatnot. I was kind of selfish, like, why me kind of thing. And I knew that it was for a bigger reason. I know that, you know, somewhere up above there's something that is telling me that, you know, hey, there's a path, believe in it. And so that's what I did, and that's what ended up getting me here.
Before the injury, Zach had generated the attention of D1 programs like Georgia, Alabama, and Auburn. He was offered a spot as a preferred walk-on by Auburn. But when the injury happened, the Tigers backed out. But Auburn's loss became West Alabama's gain as Zach signed to play with a new Tiger team in February of 2016. While battling back from injury was a frustrating time, he looks back on it now with a different mindset.
There's something that happens for a reason for all things, and I truly do believe that. You know, I go in thinking, oh, I'm a Division I athlete, and here I break my leg my first game of my senior year, and Coach G and the coaching staff just kind of took a gamble with me and gave me another opportunity, and I couldn't be more thankful for it.
He's happy to be a Tiger, especially since both his father and grandfather played for UWA.
It's pretty cool. I get a lot of attention from it. Like, hey, you know, your grandfather played here, your dad played here. My grandfather is actually in the a team picture out in the lobby in the field house. It's pretty cool. So I get to see that every day.
In Livingston, Ellie French, News Center 11.
The SEC baseball tournament began today in Hoover, and one team that desperately needs to win it all this week is Alabama. The Crimson Tide are currently one of the first four teams out for this year's NCAA tournament, so a win this week could very well move them back into postseason contention. Starting things off in the top of the third, Alabama's Peyton Wilson competing in his hometown of Hoover. That's a ground rule double right there to left field. That's going to score Caden Rose as the Tide, they jump on the board first. And we'll stick in the third inning. Owen Diodati, the Canadian. How about this smack to right field? Not too shabby, eh? Yeah, that would score two for the Crimson Tide. And just like that, Alabama, they're going to jump up to a nothing lead. And this next at bat, let's just say the Gamecocks, they're going to need a lot more than a Band-Aid to stop the bleeding. Jackson Tate, say goodbye to that one. A three-run homer from the senior lifts Alabama to a 6-0 lead, a monster inning for the Crimson Tide, and it didn't stop there. The very next inning, Alabama up 7-0 now. Sam Prater, hard hit ball to center field. Not hard enough for the home run, but it is going to score Wilson from third, and that would lift the Crimson Tide to an 8-0 lead. South Carolina, they would get on the board in this game, but being down 8-0, yeah, that's pretty hard to come back from. Alabama delivers a dominant performance, winning 9-3 to keep their postseason hopes alive. But now let's take a look at the SEC tournament bracket and just kind of an update of where we are at right now. So Florida today, well, they got the win over Kentucky. So they're going to be playing Mississippi State tomorrow, and that'll be the Bulldogs' first game of this tournament. Now with Alabama getting the win today over South Carolina, they're going to be facing number two Tennessee tomorrow for their second game. And this is all going to be double elimination. Now the game that's going on right now, that's LSU and Georgia. And then later on, we've got Ole Miss and Auburn, and we'll see if the Rebels, they're able to advance on to that second round. The SEC tournament is not the only college baseball tournament taking place this week. The Conference USA tournament begins tomorrow on the campus of Louisiana Tech. And Southern Miss will have its boxing gloves laced up and nice and tight as they fight to try and win it all. Now here's why this week's tournament is a must-win for Southern Miss. If the Golden Eagles do win it all, they'll likely take Charlotte's place of hosting an NCAA regional. But it's not as easy as just beating Charlotte in the tournament to make that happen. They also need to get past Louisiana Tech, who they'll face on Thursday if both teams win tomorrow. The Golden Eagles dropped 5 of their 8 games against La Tech in the regular season. And with the Bulldogs having home field advantage, Scott Barry knows that his team needs to play as perfect as possible.
It's really important that all phases of your game show up. You know, at that point, as we love to say, hay's in the barn from where I'm from. So you got to go out and play, and you've had enough time on the field to learn from your failures. Not that you're not going to still make mistakes, but hopefully those are going to be limited.
Southern Miss has won 3 of the last 4 conference tournaments and will look to make it 3 in a row this week.